It's an honor to welcome Kalup Linzy today to give a talk here as part of the Yale Photo Visiting Artist Series. Kalup Linzy is a video and performance artist born in Claremont, Florida, and raised in Stuckey, Florida. Linzy received his MFA from the University of South Florida in 2003. He also attended the Skowhegan School of Painting and Sculpture. Linzy has been the recipient of numerous awards, including a grant from the Louis Comfort Tiffany Foundation, the John Simon Guggenheim Memorial Foundation Fellowship, Creative Capital Foundation Grant, a Jerome Foundation Fellowship, an Art Matters Grant, the Headlands Center for the Arts Alumni Awards Residency, a New York Foundation for the Arts Fellowship in Film and Video, and most recently, a BAU Institute Travel Grant. Linzy's best known work is a series of politically charged videos that satirize the conventions of the television soap opera. His work has been included in exhibitions Frequency at the Studio Museum in Harlem, Prospect.1 New Orleans, 30 Americans, Rubell Family Collection, MoMA PS1 Greater New York, At Home / Not At Home, works from the collection of Martin and Rebecca Eisenberg, Hessel Museum of Art at Bard College. His work is in public collections at the Studio Museum in Harlem, Whitney Museum of Art, Museum of Modern Art, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Birmingham Museum of Art, the Museum of Art and New Art in Tasmania, and the Memorial Art Gallery, University of Rochester. Linzy is represented by the David Castillo Gallery in Miami, Florida, and the Breeder Gallery in Athens, Greece. He serves on the board of the Florida Museum of Photographic Arts in Tampa, and is a 2020 Tulsa Artist Fellow, which is, I believe, where he's streaming in from today. Yeah. I came to know Kalup Linzy's work over the past year and have been continually inspired by the play of his performances and the way that his works metabolize visual culture and narrative structures, creating a style that is all their own. So please join me in welcoming Kalup Linzy.
Thank you. So yeah, I wanted to, first, thank you all for being here. And I wanted to I just want to give you sort of trajectory of my art career. And I kind of want to go back to my childhood, where I had this fascination with soap operas, which informed most of my work. I grew up in a small rural town called Stuckey, Florida. And usually there was just like one TV in the house. And so growing up with my grandmother, she was a quilter and she was also deaf. But she had her whole day set out. And usually it was during the summers when like we would, if you were in the house, you had no choice but to watch what the adults were watching. And so she would watch like Donahue, Sally Jesse, then like The Price is Right. And then she would cook lunch and then sort of like sew, because she was a seamstress doing like the news. And then she would start watching like The Young and the Restless, As World Turns. And it was a Capital when I was younger, but then The Bold and Beautiful took the place of Capital in The Guiding Light. And because The Guiding Light came on at 3 o'clock, I ended up catching on to The Guiding Light, like sort of like in junior high. Like I would get out of school around 2 something, get home, and Guiding Light would be on the TV. And somehow watching these soap operas started inspiring me to want to act and perform myself. And my family, they would also tell us stories about how my great-grandmother and her daughter-in-law would listen to soap operas on the radio, like in the 1930s. And they listened to Guiding Light when it was a radio soap opera and sort of followed the soap opera when it went to television. And so one of my things, I was just always curious about my grandmother because she lost her hearing at some point, but she still continued to watch the soap opera. And so to me, that was interesting because a deaf person watching a soap opera, like how are they following these storylines? But also like a lot of the characters were white people. They would have black characters on there sometimes, but they weren't always that core audience. I mean they weren't always the core characters on the show. And so to me that was just something I was interested in because growing up in the South, you would hear these stories about racial tensions and all of that. and, you know, stay out of this area, you know, when the sun go down, like, don't be caught here and there. But at the same time, my family followed these characters that were majority white and sort of like talked about them as if they was real people, but it wasn't necessarily from like a racial, you know, point of view. But at the same time, I had never saw characters that kind of represented who I was, not just as a Black person, but also as a queer person. And so that sort of is what led me to developing my soap opera work later in college. But as a kid, you know, like I play acting with my cousins and friends in the neighborhood. And when I got in high school, I actually proposed to my like English teachers and science teachers, you know, instead of making the science project or writing a paper about a short story, could I make these video soap operas? And so they actually told me, yeah. And so I want to play the first one that I made when I was like 15, 16. I think I was 16. And I'm guessing we shot this during a spring break because it was like no adults home. And it was for a science project. And I made a couple of these in high school, but this is like the last one that sort of survived my teenage years. We would record stuff as kids and then we'd record over it. It was just something you did back then. And so like in 2010, when I had the opportunity to do General Hospital, which I'll talk about later, the high school librarian, the media center teacher, she brought this to a screening my family was having and said, oh, I have something for you. And then she gave me this tape and I was like, oh my gosh. Like I had been talking about this sort of thing like throughout my career up to that point, but I never had any images or any video to show. And so she gave this to me in 2010 and I was like, oh my gosh. So it was like a full circle moment. And so this is just a clip. You can go and watch the entire thing on YouTube, but it's showing the soap opera I did for environmental science when I was in 11th grade. And it's starring me and my cousins and my sister.
What's wrong with you?
Serious.
Starting an environmental club in the neighborhood. We want people to know they need to recycle, stop polluting, and try not to smoke. Our kids need a better tomorrow. And in order for that to happen, we have to do something today.
I totally agree on you with that. Because people don't realize when you're destroying the environment, even though you're doing it today, it does not have that big effect. But just think about it in the next few years. What about our kids and our grandkids? They won't have a place to live. They won't even be able to drink clean water. Now you better let's go play outside without taking a risk. I'll tell you, this world is going to be destroyed because of the ignorance of men.
Yeah, 16. And so later on, I graduated high school and then I went off to college and I started college in mass communications. And then I I just realized I didn't want to do like news reporting and journalism. So I was like kind of confused because I was like into media. And so my advisor, she was like, oh, well, they have film courses over there in the art department. Maybe you can go there and take some film courses there. And so I got there and it was like, oh, well, this isn't like for Hollywood. If you want to make Hollywood films, you should go to Florida State. This is more like, you know, experimental. And basically they give you a camera and tell you to go shoot, you know, you and your group of friends or your classmates, and you bring your, you know, you bring it back and then you have a critique about it. I mean, and they did teach us, you know, 16 millimeter and 8 millimeter filmmaking, but it just wasn't like geared towards the industry. And I also was interested in acting, and the thing about mass communications and theater, you couldn't really do, once you got past your second year, you couldn't do anything outside of those, you know, those disciplines. Where in the art department, you could work in film, video, painting, photography, so it was interdisciplinary. And so that was a better fit for me, although my narratives were leaning towards like TV and you know, the film industry versus what, you know, like people like Doug Aiken and Matthew Barney was doing at the time when I entered the program. And so the next video is during that period when I was preparing my thesis. And no, actually I wasn't preparing my thesis. Actually, this is gonna be my last year in undergraduate, when I created a soap opera where I was collaborating with the theater students. And so this is actually before I went to graduate school, but I felt like I wasn't ready to go out into the world. And so this was part of my graduate school submission, but not the entire submission. And so this is a clip of a soap opera called The Winding Road, where we're sort of just like, it's a student soap opera, but it's not quite what I ended up doing like years later. And so it's called The Winding Road, and it's like, it's a short clip. And this is actually not online. So I didn't write this. I actually directed it. Did I write this? Maybe I did write it. I'm not sure, but it was a collaboration with this girl, Tiffany, who's on my right. She has a long wig on. So it was a collaboration between us. And I think we shared the writing and directing. You
know what? I cannot believe Hank is bisexual. He hasn't admitted it or denied it either.
You know what? Maybe she's lying.
No.
She always lies.
No, no. No, I know she's telling the truth this time. I can feel it.
You had an abortion and you didn't tell me?
I was going to tell you.
That's where she was.
All of this time, Tiki. All of this time.
I was going to tell you tonight. I really was.
You are something else.
Who told you this?
It's not important. I know the truth.
Vicky told me.
What?
She said she overheard Chad and Nathan talking.
Oh, no. This bitch is going to pay, and she going to pay tonight.
Nathan, Vicky may be your girl and all, but her ass is mine tonight. She gonna pay for all the crimes and the destruction she done put her foot in. Oh yes, yeah, she gonna pay. And she gonna pay severely. And I promise you that.
Nathan, I want Vicky out of here now.
Hey, I'll take care of her.
You know, please let us by.
Yes, excuse me.
All right, look, wait. Before you go, what are you talking about? Never mind, it's been a long night. From her speech to everything. Let's just get a good night's sleep. Okay, and we'll just discuss it.
Fine.
Bye.
Turn the damn music off!
What's up, girl?
What in the hell are you trying to pull, Vicky? First you tell Hank and Nathan's secret, and then you try to do
tell what?
Tell what, Dexter? About the abortion that you...
So actually, I did write that. Tiffany wrote the music, and so I did write the script. And so that was like my, you know, we actually created that, and we was like, oh, we're gonna mail it to some TV networks, and they're gonna like hire us, and we're gonna redo it. So it was like all a pilot, and I ended up. So the group ended up falling apart, and so I ended up applying to graduate school. And then we actually reshot it on a different camera. But yeah, it was that weird period where also it was that time of the first internet wave. And I don't know if you all are old enough or not, but there was another, before YouTube and all of that took off, there was another internet wave in the late 90s that crashed. And so we were also getting sponsorship from like these rich people in Tampa to like sponsor it on the web, and like, we'll do a commercial for you if you sponsor this season. And so we kept redoing it. We did a soundtrack, we started doing live performances, but it just never took off, even though like the St. Petersburg Times wrote about it, like local newspaper featured us. And so I ended up going to graduate school, and I submitted like a montage of the remake of that, and the critique didn't go the way I thought it was gonna go. And I thought like, why they let me in graduate school? Because I submitted that. But I had also submitted a video that I shot with my family, like these documentaries that I was also doing. So in undergrad, I sort of did narrative videos, and then I did like documentaries, like family documentaries. And sometimes it was featuring my own family, and then I got hired by other families to do these little videos for like birthdays and like graduations and that sort of thing. And so the next video I'm going to show you is like one of those times when I was documenting my family, and I was working on my thesis, and this is during Christmas 2002. It just so happens when I walked in the room with the camera, two of my cousins was watching a soap opera, and on the holidays, soap operas, they do these flashback episodes from like 10 years or 20 years ago. And so it's a moment when we have a conversation about the soap operas. And it's really short. This is something I haven't really shown as part of my work. EAI, Electronic Internet in New York, I did a screening, I think maybe like a year and a half, 2 years ago, where I actually showed some of this documentary stuff. So I have a lot of this stuff in my archives, but it like really never made it into my body of work. And so I'm just now starting to share this stuff with people.
Pop it a little bit. Caleb.
Huh?
Ooh, Caleb.
What? What was it?
You was tooted up, honey.
Well, I hope you got it. Show the world.
Show the world. I don't think you could miss it.
Show the world. What's going on? What's going on?
Caleb. Hey. Go ahead on.
You know you want to be on TV.
Yeah.
Slide for the camera.
Did you find it? Did you find it?
What?
The thing you had me out of the act like 2 weeks.
I've been looking for it. I gotta find it. I'm gonna find it.
Two girls like that. I say, well, I hope you got to show the world. What's going on?
Okay, you committed that.
I know that's
my. I missed it.
Who remember that whole thing?
Oh, they probably grown now.
Or Olivia, that's when Olivia and Nate was married. Think of that fruit in that sitting
there. And I killed Nate off. I brought Nate back to life. Killed him again.
Okay.
You mess with this.
Oh, Merry Christmas, everyone.
That whore,
there.
Okay, who had about looking? Get him to get him to the camera. Oh, baby, they went way back. Caleb, what you filming?
You really want you go home?
I can use this for my thesis. Because I'm talking about how my family, like the soap opera's running the family.
Do
y'all
it.
Just gave me the perfect scene.
Watching them,
and then that's from 9 to 2. And then y'all talk about how it was back then.
Okay.
And I'll say how, like, most of us don't watch them that much no more, but
no
we
time.
Grew up. Yeah,
baby.
Uh-huh.
We can take it all the way back to the 80s. Oh,
okay.
Sugar. Let's just take a moment to watch it faithfully. And then
okay.
Okay.
Shut your damn mouth.
Okay.
Shut your damn mouth.
But now, keep rolling.
Okay?
Keep rolling. One TV and you had to watch.
Mm-hmm. You better.
So that was sort of like a family Christmas. Yeah, and so that's just a scene that happened. And I didn't use that scene in my thesis because the direction my work took, I actually didn't know how to incorporate it back then, and maybe enough time hadn't passed. But from there, I did create this family of characters called the Braswell family that I put in a piece called Conversation with the Children 2, All My Children. And so it's exploring gender, sexuality, class, language, race, and family. And so basically, like, the winding road is pieces, like, it's really reference heavy. And you can watch it on, I actually posted it to YouTube during the pandemic. So you can watch the entire thing on my YouTube channel. But right now, I'm just gonna show you a short clip. And then I'll tell you more. I don't want to give too much away, but from this point, this is when I started. It was the second episode of Conversation with the Children, but it's when I started making all of them episodic and having this continuous narrative, like run throughout the work, like through the years. And it's also like I came out through my work as well. So that was the thing I was going to say later on. But like in terms of my sexuality, that's when my family kind of knew that I was queer. And I didn't have like a huge coming out to everyone. I just put it in my work. And then it's like whatever, like however they took it. So I was also having this, I wouldn't say identity crisis, but I was coming to terms and trying to figure out who I was and like in the world.
What did she say?
She said I was an embarrassment to the family.
Lord, I don't know what I'm gonna do with her. I don't know why she hair hike y'all children so much.
I don't know, Grandma. It's like she don't mind me being gay as long as I don't flaunt it. I had a right to be who I am and let the world know it.
You sure do. Grandma gonna take care of it. I'm tired of them messing with my baby.
I love you, Grandma.
I love you too. Now come by later and help me share some of these peas.
I'll come by.
I'm serious. It's my own little thing I feel like I need to do. Will you sing a solo?
I don't know. I have rehearsal all day. Hold on, I got a beat. This might be Mama or Grandma. Hello.
What's up, bro?
I'm on the phone. What you want?
Who you on the phone with?
Your tired-ass sister, Tyrone.
What's she talking about?
Somebody shot and killed JoJo, and she called herself having a memorial service tomorrow.
She need to stop. She must have been watching them damn soap operas.
I don't again. Know. But what you want?
I need to borrow $20.
I do not have no money, Tyrone. Bye. I'm sorry. That was Tyrone.
What he wanted? To borrow some money?
Girl, you know it.
Hey, Mama. Why is you hair hiking my grandbabies? Mama, all I want for them to do is to do right. I don't know why they always run to you every time I get on their case.
They run to me because they know Grandma the only one who understands what they be going through. What you need to do is love your children for who they are, and when they mess up, you be there to pick them up.
Mama, I'm just calling it like I see it. I love you, Mama.
I love you too, Norlie. Now call your children and tell them how much you love them. I'll check on you tomorrow. Because if you don't do like I tell you to, you're going to have to answer to me.
Okay. So yeah, so you can also watch the entire clip on YouTube. So the other thing about the character development, so yeah, I was like thinking about my own sexuality and all of that sort of thing and thinking about gender, but I actually spent a year and a half creating those characters. Our program was a 3-year program. And so I would, in terms of character development, I would dress up as a character sometime, you know, walk into the classroom and like lip sync to music I think the character would be listening to kind of, to figure out how the character mannerisms and how they, you know, stood and how they embodied their experience. I also went to thrift stores, me and my friends, to shop for clothes. I went to wig stores. And so I spent a long time, you know, a long time figuring out who these characters was in relationship to myself. And each character, I did put a part of myself in each character, but I also looked at pop culture, also looked at like African-American history, like some of the names comes from African-American culture, like Tyrone. There was, you know, there's like almost always a character named Tyrone. This character, Nequavia, she was a name one of my cousins invented when we would play act, but it was also something that felt very African-American that people gave their names, you know, gave their children names in the 70s. I just listened, you know, to like people like Erykah Badu, who I was into, but my faculty, they were pointing to people back in the 70s. I mean, I feel like my professors actually introduced me to Nina Simone in depth, because I don't think she was someone that I was really listening to. Like I knew of, but she just had a huge presence with some of the faculty. And so I started listening to her, and like she's been with me. Like I was just listening to her yesterday, you know, and I've covered her songs recently. Like the Pointer Sisters, they had a song called Jada, but of course, you know, I was a fan of Jada Pinkett, but they was like, oh, the Pointer Sisters have a song called Jada. So we would, so depending on the generation the professor was in, that depended on their reference point. And so sometimes it was a lot of cross-generational references that I explored as I was developing this work. I wanted to have a show like Eddie Murphy. I was into Eddie Murphy and Martin, but then they were like, oh, no, you know, Flip Wilson. Like, I knew Flip Wilson, and of course I knew Richard Pryor, but like, I was still more into Eddie Murphy, you know, than Richard Pryor and Flip Wilson. But again, because of the generation thing, they had me look farther back. And also the minstrel show, that whole thing that's been haunting our media culture, you know, since way back when. I also looked at the minstrel show and sort of, you know, thought about that a lot, because with comedians, they would always say, well, whenever you see a movie like with Eddie Murphy, critics were quick to say he was a minstrel. But if you saw Robin Williams in Mrs. Doubtfire, it wasn't necessarily the same conversation. And so I was also thinking about all of those things, and that those conversations also informed my work. I also took class in Africana studies. I took screenwriting, you know, studying Joseph Campbell and plot points. And so I took all of that and incorporated into my work. So it's not just coming from a personal place. You know, I just, that personal stuff is just to make it feel more real and to create more empathy. But there is a structure that, like, I follow to these narratives. After 2003, I moved to New York, and I sort of slept on couches for about 2 years. And then I also went to Skowhegan before I graduated college. And so that experience also informed my work, but it also created a pathway for me to move to New York and have all these different contacts. And so, and those, and a lot of people helped me out. I created, like, it was still difficult for me to create work. And so my aunt ended up buying me a camera from the Home Shopping Network. So it's the same aunt you see in the Family Christmas. So she bought me a camera from the Home Shopping Network. And so I shot this piece, play The Young and the Mess on this camera. And I had a, I was in a group show at the Studio Museum in Harlem, and I was also in a project show at Tax and Spenderman. And so I ended up getting a review in the New York Times that included all my children, which you just saw, and this play with the children. When I started, when I wanted to explore gay marriage in a small town, and I didn't use the voiceovers, and so in the videos, the majority of my videos, I pre-record all the dialogue. Can you hear me? Because it says my internet is unstable. Can you still hear? Okay. So I would pre-record all the sound. And so we would actually be lip syncing to the soundtrack. And so with this particular video, The Young and the Mess, I didn't know if that was gonna like distract from the issue or make it feel like I was brushing over the issue. President Bush was in office, and there was this whole thing about gay marriage, and so I wanted to explore that, but I thought the voiceovers, because they're so animated, might have taken away from the issue. So I didn't use that technique in this particular video, but I am exploring like a topical issue that was very, very, I guess, taboo at the time. I mean, things have changed. This was 2005. And so this is also the continuation of the Braswell family. So it feels a little bit darker than the previous piece, but it got a lot of attention in the art world, and people wrote about it extensively.
What about our performance group? What about Tom and Dick?
I'm not worried about them. Taiwan. Marry me?
Have you decided what you're gonna do?
I need more time.
Taiwan, I've been in love with you for I don't know how long. I loved you before we even started dating.
I'm in love with you too, but I ain't never...
Never what? Thought about being committed for the rest of our lives?
No, I ain't never thought about no damn wedding ceremony.
In a perfect world, I should be proposing to you in front of all those people out there.
Harry, you know I love you, but I can't marry you. I'm not ready for a husband.
You turning down my proposal?
This is a small town. Men don't get married here. Hell, they don't even live together.
We can move. I have plenty of money.
Move and leave my family.
If you want to be a successful artist, you gotta get out of here anyway.
I can't do it. I gotta go. I'll call you.
What? Hello?
Aren't you gonna chase that ass?
Fuck you.
Is that what Taiwan's not gonna be doing with you tonight?
Please change your mind.
I can't get married, but I still want to be with you.
I'm not going to just shack up with you. I want to put a ring on your finger. And if I can't do that, I'm going to leave you and just leave town.
No! I'm just trying to think about my mom and my dad and the church. I need them too. I need all y'all.
You can have it all. It's just that you don't want it. I believe your family will accept us. The problem is, you don't accept us. Goodbye. Maybe in another lifetime.
So that was 2005. And so after like getting reviews and being written about like in you know, the art forms and art in America and all of that stuff, there was also this conversation about if I could sustain myself as a video and performance artist. And so that conversation was always not tough, but it was something I had to think about. And so I ended up creating a character, Katanya, who's actually a visual artist. So I would channel those anxieties into Katanya, and I started creating like these 2D drawings. I mean, they've advanced over the years. So back here, you can see they're like paintings now, but back then, they were like markers and yeah, they was basically marker drawings that kind of developed over time. And so I introduced her in a video As the Art World Might Turn and Play with the Churn. So I'm gonna play a clip of As the Art World Might Turn, which I spent off into a series. Now these videos, they are in museum collections, but again, it was this question about like the value of video and performance. It's sort of like the same conversation they was having in the 70s, the 80s about photography. Like, is it art, and like what sets it apart from television and that sort of thing? So that might seem foreign to you all if you're young, but like back then it was like a serious conversation, a serious thing you had to think about. And so this is a short clip of As the Art World Might Turn.
I'm upset too. I spent hours preparing a speech for all the VIPs of our art world. Do you mind pretending that they're here? I mean, something has to happen. Yoela Bright, the greatest art critic in the world. Thank you so much for accepting my invitation to be here. I hope you find the exhibition engaging, and I look forward to hearing your feedback. Tony Spitz, I met you in undergrad. You were one of my professor's collectors. You visited my studio and you told me you liked what I was doing and to keep it up. It's good to see you. Jan Johnson, you are one of the biggest art collectors in the world. I didn't think you would come, but you're here. It's good to see you. Martha O'Meary, I hope to have an exhibition at your museum one day. Tonight is only the beginning. Thanks for coming. I'm glad you're here. Ben Thomas, I have read every article in every art magazine you have ever written for. And I'm not just saying that. I love you, and thanks for coming. Big Feet Freddy, I told you I didn't want to rush. I felt like if we just slowed things down, we might have something. You stop rushing, and look, you are here with me, taking your time.
Okay, so Katanya's basically having anxiety about no one's coming to her show. And so people didn't come to the dinner, but they do end up going to her show. And you don't see the paintings because I didn't want to show too long of a clip, but everything turns out fine. And so I kind of continue her narrative through the years. So I'll show another clip later on where she sort of ends up. But I also want to, right now, I want to kind of switch to like vaudeville and old Hollywood, because even though most of my work was this continuous narrative, there were times when I would like sort of go and do like this piece called Lollipop, which it just came to fruition because I was in Union Square one day in the old Virgin store, which I don't think exists anymore. And you can go in and like listen to music before you buy it. And so I just saw this CD called Raunchy Business, Hot Nuts and Lollipops. And I was like, oh my gosh. And it was songs that were banned from the radio in the 20s and 30s. And I was like, oh my gosh, I got to hear this. So I listened to snippets and I was like, okay, I'm taking this home. I'm buying this. And so I was listening to this song and then I just got this idea for this video for this song called Lollipop. And so Sean Leonardo, who's a friend of mine who plays Taiwan boyfriend and The Young and the Mess, I was thinking, who could I get to do this video with me? And I was like, oh, Sean will probably do it. So I reached out to Sean, sent him the track, and he's like, he'll do it. So he showed up to my studio, the Marie Wall Sharp residency program. And I think we only used one take, but I think it only took like four takes for us to get this song. And so it's a lip sync video. And then a few years after that, I sort of want to explore the Hollywood melodrama more. So I took some of those same songs and used them to underscore the piece called Keys to Our Heart. So right now I'm just gonna play you all a clip of those two videos. I'm actually, Lollipop is short, so I decided to play that entire thing, although you can see it on YouTube. And I'm playing a short clip of Keys to Our Heart, but you can see the entire thing on YouTube. And Lollipop got a lot of attention in the world, and Keys to Our Heart premiered in Prospect, New Orleans, where I think I met, where John and I was there at the same time, right? So we were both in the show, and so Keys to Our Heart premiered there, and then it had its life in the art world as well. And these are the two pieces that people really, really respond to. Although, I mean, I like all my work, but these two end up being people's favorites.
Go away, Willie.
Oh, give me a little of that, honey.
Oh, no, keep your nasty hands off it.
Why, honey? Now, I want something so bad.
I want your nasty hands on it.
Why, honey?
Because it's mine. I ain't gonna give you none of my things.
Well, give me a little bit.
No.
Just a teeny weeny little bit.
No, now.
Why?
I'll tell you the reason why.
Well, let me know, sugar.
Now, listen here, Willie Brown.
Mm-hmm.
Ain't no use you keep hanging around. I know you want it.
I sure do.
Oh, it looks so good.
It do.
I wouldn't give you a piece, honey, if I could.
No, no, Mary.
What?
You is making me blue.
Why, Willie? 'Cause I can't give none to you. I'll play ring around roses, even play hopscotch, but I can't give you none of my lollipop.
Yeah, you can.
I know Fanny's got one.
Yeah, she got one.
And thinks it's fine.
It is.
But I bet your nickel, baby, it ain't as good as mine.
I don't know.
You know Tommy and Johnny and cute little Joe. Why, they wouldn't go to school till I give them some more.
Yeah.
Now, and if you try to take it, I'll call a cop, 'cause I ain't gonna give you none of my lollipop, none of my lollipop.
Selling nuts, hard nuts, anybody here wanna buy my nuts? Selling nuts, hard nuts, I've got nuts for sale. Selling one for five, two for ten. If you buy them once, you'll buy them again. Selling nuts, hot nuts, you buy them from the peanut man. Nuts, hot nuts, anybody here wanna buy my nuts? Selling nuts, hot nuts, nuts is mighty fine, but I bet your nuts isn't hard as mine. Selling nuts, hard nuts, you buy 'em from the peanut man. If it don't fit, don't fold it, 'cause you'll make your mama mad.
What do you
if
want?
It don't fit, don't
fold. Shouldn't you be somewhere causing someone pain and grief?
Not today. I wanted to do something positive.
Positive. Lily does something positive. Put that on the front page of the newspaper.
Funny, funny, funny.
Why are you really here?
To tell you why Dinah is the way she is.
Enlighten me, please.
Don't worry, I will. John Jay isn't innocent, and neither are you. Can you get that? I need a cup of tea.
Sure. John Jay?
What are you doing here?
I invited you both here. I wanted us all to celebrate the end of one relationship and the beginning of a new one. Come in, John Jay.
What the hell are you up to?
I just told you. Why don't I fix you a cup of tea?
This party is over. I refuse to sit here and waste my time on a bunch of bullshit.
No, please wait. I really want you to work things out with Sally Sue. I know you both feel guilty, but you two deserve each other.
I am totally confused.
It will all be clear very soon. You can't control love. Please, stay and work it out.
We need more than a party hosted by you to get over what I did to my baby. Regardless of my problems, I love Dinah.
Please don't call her your baby.
Why?
Hold that thought. Come in.
Is this some kind of setup?
So, so I did play all the lollipops, so that's on YouTube and as well as Keystar Heart. So, although I was I was influenced and inspired by like old Hollywood movies like Betty Davis and the Joan Crawford movies, you know, I was also inspired by like Cindy Sherman and Carrie Mae Weems and, you know, those artists as well. So, it was like taking all of those things and sort of having it like just inform my work and explore some of the topical things I wanted to, explore. Keys to Our Heart was, I wouldn't say a challenge, but the piece didn't turn out how the piece began. I wanted it to be like me and I think like me, Justin Bond, like, and my friend Cat Power. So Cat Power is going to play this character that was Sally Sue, who was sort of like based on Audrey Hepburn type of character. Justin Bond would have been Lily, that was sort of like the Joan Crawford. And then I was going to play Dinah, who was going to be sort of like a Pearl Bailey type of character. And Justin was off touring. Sean was off touring, like she wasn't available. And then my cousin who plays Dinah was my assistant. And I said, well, could you play Lily? Cause like I need to play Dinah, like she's more calm cause I need to be focused on directing. And she read the script, she was like, uh-uh. She said, I think you need to play Lily cause like I just don't think I can do it. And I was like, oh shit. So I knew the character was going to be tough to play, but then, because I wasn't supposed to play that character, so I kind of like just dug in, and it probably was one of the more layered, complicated characters, because I had to really push myself to go into that character and direct, and then she was a lesbian, and then the other lesbian was my cousin, she was a female cousin, so it was like no attraction, but it was trying to like find a space where this Lily character was kind of obsessing over her best friend. So it was one of those works that really pushed me, and also to like pay attention to the framing, because I was really into that I was really wanting to go, well, I was really going in a more cinematic way at this, at that particular point. And so it was some work, but again, it was still like going to the thrift store, going shopping, like going to the wig stores, the same type of approach I use in graduate school in terms of developing the characters. And it was all voiceover, so we were lip syncing during the whole production, which is fun. A lot of people would say that the work is more video art than performance art, but the actual filming of the work is performance art, because like it's a performance, like a lip sync performance, like this, that's being orchestrated, you know, while we're filming, although you don't always get that in the final product. So then in 2009, I got invited to TBA, PICA out in Portland. They say, well, is it something you want to do that you haven't done? And I was like, yeah, I want to kind of develop animation more like, you know, Catania characters, you know, like I want to kind of bring them to life more. And so I had done one short music video that I had some interns of mine at the time that were still in school animate, but I sort of really wanted to tell a full-fledged narrative. And so I did the residency, and I worked with Leica House, who's a part of Leica, and they did this movie called Coraline in the PJs that Eddie Murphy, this television series that Eddie Murphy was, that I enjoyed, but it got canceled. I don't think the NAACP was that happy with it, but they do great animation work. And so I went out to Portland to present it, but the collaboration was mostly virtual. Like I would mail them things and then email them the sound files, and we would sort of go back and forth. And so this piece is called Conversation with the Children 7, Lynn Myron's Trade, and it's also on my YouTube channel, but I'm gonna just show you a clip so you can get an idea. If you haven't been on my YouTube channel, like I don't know who's been there and who hasn't.
I can't get over what happened to Lil and Myron.
It's not your fault.
I was there.
Baby love, don't be hurt. I am here to give you love. I'm your
Hey, I've been checking you out for a while now.
Myron, I don't go that way.
Oh, I thought.
I just be looking.
You sure? I felt like
I got a girl.
I could have sworn.
I think you're cool. You know, my sister loves you. She talks about you all the time. So when I saw you.
I get it. You was just looking.
Yeah. I don't have nothing against gay people. So if you see me, holler at me. A friend of my sister is a friend of mine.
Yes.
What? I did not know he went that way.
Me neither until...
Why are you upset? He cute.
We got real freaky. Let's just say he don't wash his ass. My stomach's still turning. I can still taste it in my mouth.
B, I did not know your brother liked boys.
What about your girlfriend? What do you think is going to happen when...
I knew I shouldn't have trusted him.
So it's true?
I gave in to some feelings I didn't know I really had. I don't know.
According to Gigi, Myron claims you don't know how to wash your ass.
That motherfucking... Is this our little town?
You know the town we live in.
No more crying, no more dying, no more, no more.
So that's online. So that's 2009. So in the 2009, I ended up meeting James Franco, and he was in one of my lectures, and he said he wanted to pitch me to the producers of General Hospital. And I was like, oh, yeah, right. Like, they're really going to say yes to me being on the show. So they ended up saying yes. And so in 2010, after all these years of doing, like, my own soap operas, I was given the opportunity to appear on a real daytime soap opera. And so I'm going to play just a short story arc, but you can find, like, these clips on YouTube as well.
Well, if you ever plan to motor west, travel my way, take the highway that is best. Get your kids on Route 66. Well, it winds from Chicago to L.A. More than 2,000 miles all the way. Get your kids on Route 66. Will you go through St. Louis, Joplin, Missouri, Oklahoma City? Looks pretty, you'll see Amarillo. Dallas, New Mexico, Texas, Arizona. Don't forget Winona, Kingman, Fargo, San Bernardino. Won't you get hip to the Tiny Tea? Will you make that California trip? Get your kids on Route 66.
Definitely. Thanks for singing a Jace for me.
It was an honor.
Now, I need one more performance from you.
This time, I get to pick the song.
All right. It should be sad. Sad and haunted.
Just tell me when and where.
You know the problem with most performance art? It doesn't go far enough. You and me, we're gonna raise the dead.
So I want to, because I also appeared as a male version and a female version on the show, so I kind of want to show both, just a clip of both.
Thank you very, very much. I've been asked to perform a very special number.
It's most definitely.
No expression. No expression.
Of a matter. What you see.
Identifying a road that leads to
going nowhere. Going nowhere. And the keys are freeing up.
Saints and sinners.
No expression.
No one knew me.
No
one knew me.
I know where the baby is!
No
tomorrow. I find it kind of funny. I find it so sad. It's a mad world.
And so that piece actually incorporated performance art. And my family had this big party, and it was a huge thing. And then the media the media center teacher, she's the one that, she brought me that early soap opera that I did in high school. And so right now, because I want to open up for Q&A, I want to just go sort of show you the character family tree. And I basically created a family tree that was commissioned by the USF Contemporary Art Museum in like 2015. And so it's sort of bringing all my characters, like the family characters in these different pockets together in one piece. And so I'm creating this collage. I create this collage that is a family tree, but it's of fictitious characters. And so I haven't gotten it completely where I want it to be, but this started in like 2015. And so I want to play short clips of those videos and then like show you the installation of it. And you can watch not necessarily Days of Our Ego, but a lot of the web series that I have on YouTube features these characters, but they're in their own worlds. So like it's Melody Set Me Free. They're in like the music industry, then it's As Our World Might Turns, and they're sort of in the art world, but they're all related to each other. They're sort of like on different branches of this family. And so I wanted, you know, show these short excerpts before I open it up for the Q&A. Because it sort of brings things up to date.
KK, did you see it?
Yes. I haven't gone all the way through it.
Neither have I. I stopped at Pisces.
I can't believe she is our cousin. How could I not see it?
She changed her name.
Yeah, but I should have seen the resemblance.
What do you want to do? Is it fair to exclude her?
What?
She is our family.
You know, you would feel that way, considering you laid up with my sister's husband and had what you call love children, but what you really had were bastards.
Well, if the PhD candidate called you wasn't so damn cerebral, instead a little bit more physical, Pisces wouldn't have been able to seduce Jimmy via head.
Oh, is that how you hooked Lloyd? With the intelligence in your head? Or was it the deepness in your throat?
All the above, bitch. Considering all your sister Hope knew how to do was deep throat alcohol instead of her husband.
Oh, fuck you.
That's what Lloyd did, and so did Pisces and Jimmy. Fucked each other all the while fucking you.
Stick your head in my intelligent ass and kiss.
Tell Jimmy to do that to you and not to Pisces. What, you can't tangle with old cuz? I'll shut any bitch down, kin or no kin.
I can't believe this. All that work, all that effort.
What? I thought everything was good.
No. The Queen Rose family canceled the commission.
This is my family too. And if KK and Lisa don't want to do this project, I'll do it. Hell, I'm Florida Queen.
So I'm just zoom right through these. Just to bring you all up to date, because I feel like
I can't believe we are finally going to do this.
Yep, the day is finally here. Me and my girl getting married.
Hello?
Cousin Joseph, did you get my message?
Yeah, we got it.
Are y'all gonna participate?
Here, talk to my wife.
Hello?
Irma.
This new.
Are y'all gonna participate in the tree project?
I don't know why he put me on the phone. I told him I didn't stand by my picture in the gonna come to my house to get no picture, cause I don't want nobody looking at my picture. Now, here's that your cousin.
Hello?
What about you, cousin Joseph?
Just put our name on it and call my daughter Grace. She might do it.
Big Feet Freddy, I remember when you used to move too fast. Now you take your time. I promise to take my time with you, no matter what. I promise to always embrace the magic, chemistry, good feelings between us. When negativity approaches, invades, tries to take over, I promise to let that shit go. Big Feet Freddy?
Katanya, I promise to love you no matter what. When the world is coming for you, whether it be for your art, something you say, or something you believe in when everybody else doesn't, I promise to stand by you, love you, and keep our love crunk. From the start, you were that good place in my heart. And until the end, I hope you will let my love make you feel zen.
I now pronounce you husband and wife. Big Feet Freddy, you may kiss your bride. I can't believe. This.
It's a good thing, right? At least Kike Queen and Lisa made up. That story was pretty epic.
Yeah. Our ancestors paid them a visit. I can't believe I'm related to the Queen Rose family. And the commission is back on. Sometimes we don't all show up. Sometimes we don't all get along. You know you wrong. Did you pick up the phone and call old cuz? Or were you too occupied with your buzz? Yes, we all have an ego. However, we can still spread the love. So, as this exhibition travels, different family members will gather. We will take turns representing, presenting us. Because love is what we will trust. I'm Florida Queen.
Now, don't get no big head or ego because you got a traveling exhibition.
Yeah, but the whole family wasn't there together.
Shit, they were together. Together on that museum wall. You the boss.
What you mean? You the boss. You the one got me big.
No, we both got you big.
That mean we both big.
That's right.
Put my song on.
So, and now this is just a documentation of the installation.
Thank you.
Okay, and yeah, and so I also do music. So I'm just gonna play like this quick montage of music, and then we'll have Q&A. Some of the characters I play in the videos, I bring them outside of the videos for like live performances, and I shoot music videos with them and release albums. So you can find albums on Spotify and iTunes and like on the web. And then after this, we'll open it up to questions. And that exhibition was a two-person show in Fort Myers, Florida, that James and I, the curator wanted to curate like our collaborations and at General Hospital thing into one exhibition. And so that was in 2017, I think. And so here are just a montage of some of my music work.
Asshole, asshole, asshole. Take it there. I looked again, saw somebody else. Don't take my peace, silently I scream.
Gotta get you home to the bed. Gotta get you home to the
I gotta
get you home to the bed.
I gotta
get you home to the bed.
I gotta
get you home to the bed.
Gotta
get you home to the bed.
I'm also doing like a fashion line as well. So you can see one of the characters in like some of the Catania print. And so you can find those videos are online on YouTube as well. And so that's kind of where I'm at. I also recently did a genetic ancestry thing. So I'm gonna incorporate some collages, with that to kind of continue the family tree, and hoping to do more TV and, work in film and teach classes here and there. And so that's kind of where I'm at.
Thank you so much, Kalup. That was such a pleasure to see so much of your work all at once. I think you're narrating it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.